Hey, everybody. Welcome to Roger and Me, aka Roger Ebert and Me, a movie review podcast for SEO, search engine optimization purposes. What are we? We are a Siskel and Ebert tribute podcast. And by that, I mean, we are just keeping that general idea of two dudes talking about movies that come out every Friday. Every week, that's what we do. We talk about the new releases. Sometimes there are three, like last week. Actually, that's like the only time that's happened. More often, there are eight, like this week. There are eight new releases out this week in theaters and on streaming. So we've got major releases from Disney, aka Disney, which now owns Lucasfilm, I guess. So we've got Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. That's the biggest one, obviously. We've got a DreamWorks animated film called Ruby Gillman, Teenage Kraken. We've got a Netflix animated film called Nimona. We've got a Netflix horror film that I saw at Sundance in January and haven't thought about a lick since. But I think we can muster up a nice conversation about that one because I do remember it being particularly uninteresting. We've got Prisoner's Daughter starring Brian Cox and Kate Beckinsale. And Ernie Hudson, directed by Catherine Hardwicke. But it's going in a couple theaters, maybe. It's not getting much of a release. Why is that? We'll tell you. Movies you probably haven't heard of include Millie Lies Low, The Passengers of the Night, and Love Gets a Room. Mark, what's up? I have to introduce you. I forgot to do that. This is Mark Dujsik of MarkReviewsMovies.com. What's up, Mark?
I'm the other dude talking about movies. Yes,
it's true. The more arguably doing way more work because if you go to markreviewsmovies.com, you will see not only does he do the written component for every single one of the movies we're going to talk about, which is a lot more work than I put in. He also reviews movies that I don't make time for that are also good. This week, there's a couple things you watched that you rated 3 stars, including a documentary about the lives of intersex people. I think 3 intersex people are followed, and there's a documentary about it called Everybody, and I've heard it's good, and Mark's it's also good.
Yeah.
There's a movie called, is it really just The Child, or is it The Childie?
Yeah, I think it's just The Child. I'm not 100% certain, because I knew we weren't going to talk about it, so I didn't bother looking at the pronunciation.
Well, yeah, it's The Child.
Which is lazy of me,
e
but what am
end.
I going to do? Yeah. It's a South Korean action film that's a thriller action film. It's actually a lot of fun. Somehow that review has blown up on Twitter because apparently one of the stars is a big TV star making his movie debut.
Okay.
And so all of the fans of that actor are going everywhere for this movie. It's good, and he's really good in it. He plays this very off-kilter hitman, and it's a really fun performance for fans.
I love
Korean TV.
I'm now going to put that title in the description so we can siphon off that Twitter.
As soon as that hit, I'm like, oh no, it's too late to tell Brett to watch this.
Oh, it's okay. It does sound right up my alley, and I will seek it out. It sounds great, but it also sounds like a movie that do you know where it's released? I don't know if it's playing.
It's
anywhere.
In theaters. I mean, I mean, I can't tell you like everywhere is playing, but it's out there.
Oh wow, it's playing. I can see it with my AMC A-list in New York at the AMC Empire, which is the AMC in Times Square.
Week.
Yeah, maybe we'll talk about The Child with an E next week. And you also talked about 2 other things that you rated 1 star each, which I'm assuming are just unbearable. And one is called The Man from Rome. And the other is War Horse One. What is there to say about these movies, Mark?
Let's see. War Horse One is sort of a one-man show. It's actor, co-director, co-writer, editor, final colorist, composer.
What can he do?
I know. Johnny Strong, that's his name, as one man against the entire Taliban in Afghanistan trying to rescue the daughter of a missionary. And it's just... It goes on forever. Lots of shooting off screen, two ways in geographically different locations. It looks like they're shooting at each other in completely the wrong angle. Anyway, so that's not that good. And then
so when I say what can't he do, shoot a movie,
stage, choreograph action is one of them.
There's a lot of options. It appears.
Yeah. And then The Man from Rome is perhaps the weirdest unofficial audition for James Bond. It has Richard Armitage playing a priest who's part of the Vatican's intelligence bureau, who has to go to Seville, Spain, and try to figure out the mystery of a killer church. So he's basically a priest spy who has been has a dispensation for all of his vows and is allowed to basically do anything. it's so silly. I was kind of on board with it until you realize it's just a boring movie about a guy wandering around Spain, occasionally fighting some people, just trying to talk to others about why this church is killing people. And lots of land deal talk. Lots of real estate talk.
Wow.
It's dull, and it should not be that dull for a movie about a gun-toting priest. But.
Well, there you have it. If you want to read more about The Man from Rome or War Horse 1, which is not a sequel, nor is it a prequel to War Horse.
No.
There's no horses at all?
No horses. No horses.
That's a shame. All right. Well, let's get into the actual movies we're going to talk about, with one we're going to mildly disagree on. I don't feel super strongly negatively about this movie, but I definitely don't feel positively about it, where I think that's where Mark steps in. So we will talk about Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny, and I'm sure we'll also end up talking about Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull and other such films. Here is the trailer for Dial of Destiny.
I'm retiring.
Well, in that case, what are we drinking?
Same for the goddaughter.
Dad told me you found something on a train during the war. A dial that could change the course of history.
Why are you chasing the thing that drove your father crazy?
Don't move.
We need to get out of here. Sorry.
Helena!
Dr. Jones, get him.
Hitler made mistakes, and with this, I will correct them all.
You stole.
If there's one thing, Mark, that I think is great about this movie, is that you can boil it down to the premise, Indiana Jones has to save Hitler. And it kind of works.
Oh, no.
I don't mean to say it has these ulterior motives or anything. It is just, if you were to boil down the plot to like, okay, what's he got to do? It unfortunately could be summed up in that way. And I actually think that's kind of what's fun about it. I know a lot of people are calling this one like wacky or silly. And I'm like, have you seen the other ones? I feel like they all get this wacky and silly, especially when the like third act has to reveal whatever the MacGuffin is and what it has to do. But I guess we'll get to this more in a couple of weeks when we talk about Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1, which Mark and I have both seen. But it's kind of the summer of the MacGuffin split into two parts. And let's talk about Dial of Destiny, Mark. What walk me through it.
I will try to walk you through it as best as I can. So it is Indiana Jones in the present day of the movie. It's 1969. And what I really liked about this is that it confronts this idea of everybody is currently looking towards the stars, the moon, and the future. And where does that leave somebody like Indiana Jones, who is stuck in the past? He has lived his entire life and has made his entire career looking into the past, and nobody cares anymore. So what do you do with Indiana Jones in this kind of world? And that's kind of where we're at right now, too, in the movies, is that we are looking at all these big visual effects blockbusters. Everybody is looking forward to making franchises. Obviously, this is a franchise. This is one of the, I think, inherent problems with the movie. Even though I did enjoy it, I'm going to come out and say it. I enjoyed it. So it's about Indiana Jones in a more modern time. And what does he have to do? And can he still be entertaining and have fun? And that's the big question. So he is out looking for Archimedes' dial, which is rumored, as all things in these movies are, rumored to have some magical supernatural powers. And yeah, he's joined by his goddaughter, played by Phoebe Waller-Bridge, who I thought was quite a bit of fun in this. She's,
yeah, I like her.
You know, okay, good. I'm glad, because there's a lot of backlash against her for some reason.
Oh, well, that's because if you cast a woman in anything, the online community is, there's going to be, I feel like it's more the media finding those things now and being like, we know people like to click on crap that says this crap. I just hate the whole thing. But you're right. Because, of course, that it's pocket annoying. Of the internet. Yeah.
I don't know what's more annoying. The fact that all these people are instantly, reflexively offering up all this backlash and hatred towards any woman who is cast in a movie against a, you know, traditional male hero, or everybody focusing on the fact that it's happening. Can we just ignore that section of the internet once and for all? Anyway,
totally with you.
That's my opinion on that. Anyway, so it's a lot of chasing, a lot of searching, typical Indiana Jones movie. I'm going to stop there. I think that's a good summation, at least of the plot and some thoughts on it. I enjoyed it. That's what it comes down to. And I think you enjoyed it less. Or
where did
not
you
at
land?
All?
I enjoyed it less is what I would say. But did you where did you land on Crystal Skull for text of the listener who might be someone who either loved it or hated that and needs to know going in what to expect because you liked it?
Okay, I liked Crystal Skull. There's obviously some issues with the visual effects, although what's funny is that I watched it again before this one. The visual effects are still wonky, but they hold up better than some of the stuff that's out there in theaters right now.
I would agree.
That's surprising. I think that's because it's Spielberg. Oh, I forgot. I buried the lead. Spielberg isn't directing this. It's James Mangold.
That's
who directed
right.
Logan and the 310 to Yuma remake. And
what's
other
that? Did
movies.
You say James Mangold? James Mangold, Indiana Jones?
Mangled. Oh, no. No, don't do that.
I'm just teasing. If I didn't like it more, I would have led with that. But
that would have been a good one.
It would. Thank you. My problem with this movie is more that it never really makes the case that it should exist for me. Like, it never really justifies its existence, because for me, it's like, why do you want to see an Indiana Jones movie? It's like, because Steven Spielberg directed it. Right? Like, that's kind of a big part of it. So this one doesn't have that big part of it. And I think James Mangold is a totally serviceable, and that's like damning him with faint praise. That's serviceable's mean. I think he's a good director. I quite like a lot of the things he's done. What is his last movie, Ford vs. Ferrari? I thought that was great. And I think he's done three Wolverine movies, two Wolverines, and a Logan. Logan's very good. I don't think he's a bad director, but when I'm watching an Indiana Jones movie, I'm expecting like big, exciting, elaborate, actually staged set pieces. And instead, I feel like what we get here, they're all like, they do try to do that stuff, but it all feels slightly off. And I think a lot of it has to do with like how much of it is digital. And it just inherently rubs me the wrong way that like Indiana Jones in the digital world now. And again, it's of course, then you're going to say, well, we're making an indie movie in 2023. Of course, they're going to use the tools at their disposal. And that's where I go. Inherently, I agree. I don't think they need to make this fucking movie in Indiana Jones 5 where an 80-year-old man is digitally de-aged for the first 20 minutes of the movie or whatever. 15? Maybe less. It's not that long. It feels like it's way too long, actually, the opening scene that goes on. I don't know how you felt about the digitally de-aged stuff. But what I will say about that is I was actually impressed when like the camera pans down or whatever it is, and it's revealed that it's a young Indiana Jones, and you know that it's like Harrison Ford's there, but his face is de-aged. It looks good. And then I would say that effect is completely undone when he starts talking, because he's talking, it sounds like an 80-year-old man. And I think that's a problem that is inherent to this technology. I feel like Irishman had different problems with the effects. Like, it didn't look as good on the face. And there were the part where Robert De Niro goes and kicks the shit out of somebody. It felt like you were watching an 80-year-old man kick somebody. And it really took me out of it. So I just think that whole digitally de-aged industry, well-meaning maybe, the intended effect kind of null and void for me if you don't also do some work on the voice. Because it just sounds like Indiana, it sounds like current day Harrison Ford. And it ruined the effect for me. And that sequence also, Mark, maybe you disagree. But that whole sequence ends up, it's kind of, I understand what it's going for and I want to enjoy it. It's doing the crazy fun Indiana Jones thing. I like the bomb through the the floor or whatever. Like, I think you wrote about that in your review.
It's a great bit.
It's a great bit. And that's a great bit that I enjoyed. But like, then I'm also watching like motorcycle stuff that I swear to God, Mark, looks identical to a sequence in the movie Tintin, which would be a compliment maybe, but Tintin is a fully CG animated movie. And it just took me out of it again to be like, damn, I'm watching an Indiana Jones movie in 2023. And it's just like a fully CG animated stuff going on here. And it just kind of reminded me that like nowadays, I feel like iconic action adventure franchises are now indistinguishable from something like Uncharted, where it's just like, yeah, we'll do it in most. And I feel like this problem isn't just Indiana Jones's problem. I'm going to say this a little bit about Mission Impossible, maybe. I'm going to say this about a lot of movies. I said this about the Fast and the Furious movies. I say this about a lot of stuff. It's a blockbuster problem. So putting that aside, why didn't I like this movie more? Because I am conceding that it does some Indiana Jonesy stuff decently, but it all feels like it's approximating it. It never quite feels to me like it is one. It does kind of feel like it's trying to be one rather than it is one. It just, there's a not quite rightness to it. And I found it to be flat and kind of uninspired at times. And it wasn't particularly funny. I can't remember any particularly funny lines. And I just wasn't engaged in a way that I wanted to be. And I'll also concede that I thought I was an Indiana Jones person. I saw them in high school for the first time, maybe late junior high, and was very excited by them and was like, wow, I can't believe I hadn't seen these. These are amazing. And then rewatching them before this, I came to the realization that I think I just like Raiders. I think I like Raiders, and I have various problems with the sequels. I think Last Crusade is probably the best one, but I didn't really care for Temple of Doom. And Crystal Skull, I like fine for the first 40 minutes, I think are great, and then it kind of loses me a little bit. At some point, Mark, doesn't it feel like it's speed running? Like all the different Indiana Jones movies, like they've got the kid. There's a kid in this movie that makes no impression whatsoever. And it feels like they're doing Temple of Doom. It's got the, Phoebe Waller-Bridge is kind of not, I don't want to give her, I don't want to say she's Kate Capshaw-y because she's not. And that role is, you're muted. Sorry. I don't know if you want.
Oh no, I know. I was sorry. Yeah. I was just being silently.
Yeah.
Agreeing with the disagreement about the Capshaw, any kind of Capshaw.
I would not burden her by saying that. No. I think that Capshaw performance is really bad, but it's also like the role sucks. And it's just like outdated misogynist, like, oh, this fucking broad humor that just doesn't work at all. So like the Phoebe Waller-Bridge feels like a correction to stuff like that. But like, and I think she's great and I think she's fun. But like, there's also the quality of like Toby Jones shows up in the opening scene, which such a perfect fit for one of these movies. And then he's just, you know, he doesn't participate in the rest of the movie. And then I feel like the whole, it's just funny that they're like, yeah, Phoebe Waller-Bridge is his goddaughter because she was, you know, she knew this guy or whatever. And it's just like, you introduce someone so you could introduce someone, which is like a quality I feel like these sequels all have in the Indiana Jones verse. But yeah, it does feel like it's speedrunning each different movie. There's a lot of Raiders in it. There's a lot of Temple of Doom in it. There's a little bit of Crusade in it. And I don't know. I just didn't find it super captivating. And I think it's all that digital stuff that just like rubs me the wrong way about all these things, rubbed me the wrong way. And I saw it with the crowd that was like clapping when it started, very excited and just kind of non-responsive the whole movie. It just felt kind of perfunctory. And yeah, it's like, I want to engage with the, you know, Nazis in 2023 commentary that they're doing. That's like very post-Trump. They're definitely taking on Nazis. They say Nazi, the word Nazi, a lot in this movie. But again, not that that's part and parcel of what these movies are as well. There's like a Indiana Jones as Gran Torino, take me back to the old days kind of stuff going on in the movie. And I wish that stuff was mined better, I think. And I wanted more from that. And I want to talk deeply. I would love to talk about the third act. But I feel like all I'll say about the third act is that this movie is called The Dial of Destiny, right? And it seems to be a time travel thing. And I would say the movie is decidedly disinterested in any time travel stuff until it is. And then I don't know if it's like too little too late for me, maybe. But I guess again, all those complaints you could say about the other ones. So like, I think it's more a me problem than the movie problem. And I do think general audiences, not to be condescending or anything. I'm just saying, like, I think moviegoers will enjoy this movie more than, like, the can response would have led you to believe. Like, I think it's more enjoyable than even I'm making it sound for most people. I'm conceding that, like, I don't think these sequels are for me. I just like the first one, really. please respond to my many words.
Yes. Okay. My big issue with it is you have this entire premise of Indiana Jones in the modern day, why not, and trying to figure out his place. His place is, yeah, more practical stunt work, more practical type effects. And you're right. I wish the visual effects in this are distracting, if only because they are obvious and they are trying to, you're correct, recreate that sense of the action from the original films. And I wish that Mangold had done some more practical stunt work. Obviously, that's difficult when you have an 80-year-old star.
Totally.
In it, yeah. But you could still work around it. But right now, when the way that everything is with all of the visual effects and the coloring of the film makes it even more apparent, that's something that I didn't really talk about in my written review, but you can tell, like, oh yeah, these are visual effects. But he's on the horse in the subway, which is also a really fun sequence. You can tell, like, yeah, this is all very, very fake. And I wanted a bit more of that old school, old fashioned practicality to the action.
Yes.
And it's not there. And I will agree that that is definitely a downside to this. But I still really enjoyed that opening sequence. I think the de-aging works to the degree that it can. It's strange that we have, do you remember, I think it was Age of Adeline? I think that's what it was called.
I remember the movie. It starred Blake Lively.
And Harrison Ford. And there
I
is,
never saw
I believe,
that. No.
Oh, you didn't? Okay. There is a flashback to a younger version of Harrison Ford's character, and they cast a dead ringer for a young Harrison Ford in that. And everybody thought it was all visual effects somehow. And like, no, this guy just looks like Harrison Ford. There are people out there who are lookalikes and can pull it off. Why don't do that? Pull these actors in who can do that, who can look like Harrison Ford or somebody else and do that. I hate
it's
digital
an expensive,
de-aging.
Exactly. Yeah. It's an expensive answer to a problem that doesn't exist, right?
Did Solo, the Star Wars prequel Solo, kill off that idea? Is that what's happening here? Because people didn't buy
that's an interesting
a different
question.
Actor. And I, so going back to Harrison Ford, is that what the problem is? I wonder.
Maybe you're right. It is a response to something like that. I just think people, you know, people want to use technology. And there's new tech. They're going to try to use it. The really egregious thing about this movie, Mark, which like is neither here nor there. I hate talking about budgets and box office when we review movies. I think it should be two separate conversations.
Yeah.
But this movie cost $300 million before marketing spend, before screening spend, like before any other spend. It cost them $300 million to make this movie. And it doesn't look it. That's the thing. The problem with the $300 million movie in 2023 is that you can't see where the money is because the money just goes into this digital effects hole. And like, I of course want the visual effects artists to be well compensated. I know they're very overworked and I'm sure a lot of it is like overpaying them for how much fucking time they spend. Maybe that's what it is. But like, it's insane to me that $300 million movie today, this is what that looks like. Because back in the day when you heard like they spent $150 on this in 1990, whatever, like, you know that they fucking built stuff and broke stuff and exploded stuff. And it's crazy to me that these are our $300 million blockbusters. This is the eighth most expensive movie ever made. And my point is, you would never know that by just like looking at it with your eyes. And that sucks. But that's like a burden that this movie, it's like undeserved, you know, it's unfair to say it's a problem with this movie and this movie only. It isn't. It's an industry-wide thing. And this movie just happens to have that problem too. I really want to talk about the implications of the third act and how
I do too.
Kind of stuff is, but we can't.
The only thing I think I can say is that it is probably the most over the top, absurd, third act of the entire series, and I'm all on board with that.
Yeah,
because it fits thematically too. That's the important part, is that there is an actual point to having that happen, and it means something to Indy. That happens and how he's going to respond to it. I Yeah, I'm down for that.
When I think about it, and when I if I were to talk to you about that ending right now, I would be giddy talking about it because I agree. Yeah. I thought it was fun and I was into it. And like, I just wish that the movie were like the sum of the things I liked about it, because I would say there's like, you know, there's definitely like half an hour of things in this movie that I loved, but the movie's like 2.5 hours long. Is that right? It's like long.
Yeah,
it's definitely longer than the other ones. And so like, I don't want to be too cruel and say it's awful, but like the big issues I have are so big. And like they do ruin the movie for me in a big way, kind of. But like, I do want to, like, I do think the premise with the Nazis, basically the premise is the Nazis think Hitler was a bad leader, so, and that they could do a better job now. So like, what if we sent me from today back then to run the Nazis? I think that's such a fun Indiana Jonesy premise, and it does work with the lost in time thing that the movie's doing. But I just think they don't sell it enough for me. Like the movie around that idea isn't fun enough, and the like hijinks, you know, the going from one place on the map to the next type of shit, it's all perfunctory instead of fun for me. So I'm gonna stick, I think, with my 2 stars, even though I think there's an argument to be made that I could go 2.5, but I'm not going to. I'm going to stick with 2 because inherently I don't want a digital $300 million Indiana Jones movie that looks like kind of every other blockbuster that gets made at not that level of budget, but like 100, you know, expensive, but not that expensive. Is there anything else you want to say about it?
Yeah, I'm low 3. I was on the fence about it, but I did come around to I really like that opening sequence. It recaptures that spirit, even though it is all visual effects, but it's fine. It's still an elaborate set piece. It goes all over the place, from this castle to a train with the motorcycle stuff. There's a lot of fun stuff in there. And yeah, it's nice to see Ford having fun in this role again. He's clearly, he's a washed up Indiana Jones, but he eventually finds that spirit again. That's the whole point. The character is having a rough time. His wife left him. His son is dead. And he's just trying to fit in the world and doesn't know his place anymore. And then he goes on an adventure and suddenly that spark is back. It's a good performance in the middle of all this stuff. Waller Bridge is fun. Yeah, I'm mixed on it, but I am ultimately positive. And I think that's mostly because the parts that do recapture that Indiana Jones spirit are really good, and the stuff that doesn't, is perfunctory, but it's not bad.
Also confused by how little they do with Antonio Banderas. Like, you've got Antonio Banderas and you just like,
and Mads Mikkelsen
also is what I was gonna say. Like, he's a great idea on paper for the villain, and I don't think he gets to do much either. And like, he even's given the opportunity to like get like a nasty facial scar or something cool and definitive. They give him that moment and then they don't give him anything. And I was just like, all of it feels kind of like they didn't put the effort in or something. Like, there's a little effort. I don't know where the effort went. The effort went to the digital effects, I guess.
Yeah.
And there you have it. So that was a lot to say about Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. And I think that was a good conversation. So let's move on to what will be a less good conversation, because I don't know what the fuck to say about this one, really. Ruby Gillman, Teenage Kraken.
Your mother never told you you were royalty. The women in our family have the mighty power to turn into giant kraken.
What now?
Ruby, you're a princess. Address the crowd.
I think I am having a panic attack.
Well, in this movie, when a character has a panic attack, they say, "I'm having a panic attack." In a movie, a better animated movie, also from DreamWorks, the Puss in Boots, The Last Wish. When a character has a panic attack, it is the most terrifying, beautifully animated and rendered big bad wolf guy or whatever it was. It was terrifying and genuinely scary. And there you go, right? What could speak that speaks volumes between the difference between like a good DreamWorks movie and a bad DreamWorks movie. This movie feels like it's trying to be Turning Red, like a DreamWorks answer to Pixar's Turning Red, about a girl. That movie's about a girl who turns into like a big furry panda or whatever. And it's kind of like a metaphor for growing up, getting your period or whatever. And Ruby Gillman, Teenage Kraken, doesn't have as like clear a metaphor going on or anything. But it's also about a girl who becomes becomes monstrous and doesn't know about what that means. And I don't know. It doesn't really mind that very well. And then it's also like trying to be the anti-Little Mermaid. It seems to be... This movie is essentially anti-mermaid propaganda, if you really think about it. That's kind of all that's going on. I don't really know what to make of this, but asterisk, it's a movie for children. I think small children will be entertained. I was immediately almost out, Mark, just by like how the rapid fire the movie was going and the pacing. And I was like, oh, it's just one of those movies with like, they're going to be like, it's me. I'm Ruby. Here's my dog. And they cut to the dog doing something stupid. It's kid stuff. And I didn't care for it. And, you know, we review kids movies all the time and every now, and we'll review one in a minute. That's actually good. But this one did nothing for me.
Yeah, it did nothing for me either. And I'm very disappointed in that because it took me out right at the beginning too, because it has this whole thing setting up the world of the Krakens and the world of all these other beasts that they were in a war with. And then you have this family of Kraken or Krakens, I don't know what the proper pluralization is. We'll go with Krakens on land trying to hide and become normal. And it just skips over that. It feels like we're in the middle of the fourth or fifth entry in this movie, in this series. And it's the first movie, not based on any pre-existing material. And
it was very confusing. I had no idea. So I'm like, okay, so you're just pretending to be human, even though you look the way you do.
And they do not look human at all.
I guess they're trying to be like, they're human-like, but then they grow really big, and that's when they're the Kraken. But I'm like, no, when you're small, you're still like a squid. you don't look like a human. Not to be like, I did this with Elemental. I just couldn't get behind the whole world. And maybe this one's a little less, or a little hard, like, easier to get behind, because it doesn't hammer rules down your throat. But like, I was thinking about how confusing it was immediately. Just like, well, I don't really understand why they're pretending to be human, and specifically Canadians, because no one asks questions about Canadians.
It's a throwaway joke, and it's funny at first. Then you're like, but
they hammer
it. There's a whole bunch of jokes that could be done with these characters trying to fit in, who clearly are not human, trying to fit in and convince people. No, seriously, we are human beings. It would be a lengthy Conehead sketch, I guess, but that would be more promising than what they give us, which is just, they're there and they blend in as human. And then there's this huge plot with mermaids and, you know, her discovering her grandmother is the queen of the Kraken and learning all of her superpowers. It just becomes this generic thing. It never finds its own identity or personality or sense of humor, I think. And there's so much potential there for some good gags and some good jokes and just an actual story that doesn't feel like every other story beyond just Turning Red. I mean, it's this whole thing of like discovering your powers and then you get to use them for this big plot of somebody trying to take over the world. I mean, superhero stuff. That's all that it is. And it doesn't have anything else beyond that.
It makes no impression. And it's also like, it just ends up becoming like a cycle of pop song, like montage sequences that are like, not, I don't know what I'm supposed to do while they're swimming around, while the pop song plays. I'm just like, okay, again, it's for children. I don't really have much more to say. We can move on, I think, unless you have anything to add.
The only thing I'd say is that it's for children, but that's not to, you know, just say like, oh, it's nothing. There could be something there, even if it is for kids. Like you said, we're about to talk about something. I kind of want to get to that more, so I'm ready to give up on this one. But yeah, I mean, just because it's for kids isn't a reason to just say like, oh, you could just do the bare minimum. Kids get stuff.
I found it annoying. Like the voice performances, like Annie Murphy, who I like on Schitt's Creek, was like very annoying as this Ariel character.
I mean,
she's supposed to be, but like, so I guess great job, but like, it doesn't like make me enjoy it anymore. It was just, yeah, every story beat was so familiar. There's nothing to it. There's nothing to it. Two stars, like a very nice two stars.
Yeah, I same. Would say. Exactly.
Very,
the same
very kind of us. Let's talk about Nimona, the movie on Netflix that I'm surprised I enjoyed and surprised I watched and surprised I enjoyed. Here it is. Nimona.
The queen killer is still out there.
Everyone is scared. He's a murderer.
He's a monster.
He's perfect. Hey, boss.
No. Who are you?
The name's Nimona. Your sidekick has arrived.
I don't need a sidekick.
Every villain needs a sidekick.
I'm not a villain. The real villain is still out there, and I do need help.
And then, who do you want to kill first?
What?
Look, I can help you, but promise me you won't freak out.
Why would I trust you?
Promise.
I promise.
Even when you see the horn?
Horn.
Promise.
I promise, promise, I will not freak. Oh.
This is the part where you run.
It's another movie where a little girl transforms into something monstrous, but she can transform into anything, monstrous or otherwise. She is a shapeshifter. This is Nimona. Tell me about this movie and why it's two adult men both enjoyed it.
Yeah, because it does everything that Ruby Gillman doesn't do. It creates a world that is believable. It has characters that have depth to them that was a genuine surprise, especially since it all starts off with, you know, big chase and everything, and that's all it is, and some one-liners, and I was surprised how much depth there is to these characters. It's everything that Ruby Gillman isn't. It is set in a world that is based entirely on the old knighthood chivalric monarchy sort of thing. Like, if you just took medieval times and locked it all in, and then 1,000 years pass and this entire kingdom becomes a place with flying cars and giant video billboards, but they still have this sense of tradition to everything. I was on board right at the start. I'm like, okay, yeah. I'm down with this. I see what you're doing in terms of the design. It makes sense. And then yeah, there's a deep thematic core to it, because you're talking about this society that is based on certain values, and what do those values mean? Because Riz Ahmed's character, he's voiced by Riz Ahmed, he is a commoner who breaks this entire long cycle and becomes a knight. Usually you have to be born into a noble family to become a knight. He becomes a knight, and then there is a secret plot to kill the queen and frame him as doing it. And he becomes, even though he was just a hero a second ago, suddenly he's suspected of being a regicidal maniac. Yeah. Everybody dismisses him and once again thinks, oh, just a commoner. Of course it was going to happen, because he's not of noble birth and all this stuff. And then this other character, Nimona, voiced by Chloe Grace Moretz.
She's also an outsider. She is so good.
She is so good in this. Yeah.
Most I've ever enjoyed her, probably. She's great.
Yeah. She's also an outsider for obvious reasons, because she can shapeshift and she's been trying to hide it for this whole time. There's this really, really nice allegory about prejudice and how society can just create that and perpetrate it, while it's also telling this really fun adventure story and developing these characters in a way that, again, I was very, very surprised how much I grew to care about these characters by the end. And there is some really touching stuff. There's a flashback to Nimona's history where you realize, like, oh, this is who she actually is, and this is why she's in hiding, and this is why she wants to completely destroy the entire society that's here. And you're like, oh, okay, I get it. I don't know. And it looks fantastic.
It does. I like the style.
It's computer animated, but it has the look of 2D animation, of hand-drawn animation, but just, you know, right there moving around. I'm a fan of this one.
Yeah, I enjoyed it too. It's very basic, like, you know, don't judge people based on what you hear about them. Like, people aren't one thing. Also, like, once everyone sees you as a villain, that's what you are, no matter what you do. Like, that's what they're fighting against. And it has that great messaging, and I think this movie proves you don't have to have a very convoluted, very one-to-one metaphor device CC Pixar Elemental to get at real human feelings about people blindly othering others and persecuting others for their differences. You can just, like, you know, be a movie about that, that's about that, and it doesn't have to be the most crazy thing about your emotions or whatever. I don't know. I was just impressed with it on that level. I'm like, this actually works, and it's getting me on that emotional level. But also, it's just funny. Like, Chloe Grace Moretz is very funny. The character's funny. Like, she's delighted when she meets this guy because she can, you know, do a bunch of bad stuff with him, and she has fun with that. And she, what did she say when she, like, oh, yeah, because he's got one arm, and there's a bunch of guards in a room, and she's about to kill them all, and she goes, the one-arm club's about to get some new members. Like, it's just, like, stupid little one-liners that... It also feels a little more adult. I mean, it's definitely a kid's movie, but, like, there are dark jokes, and it's about... There's, like, murder jokes and stuff like that. I don't know. Maybe all kids' movies are a little dark now, but this one definitely feels a little edgier. And you're right. Good voice performances. Cute movie. Didn't overstay its welcome. I enjoyed it. 3 stars for Nimona.
3 stars for me too.
Now let's
definitely worth checking out. It's on Netflix now.
Totally agree. And let's stay on Netflix. This one's also on Netflix now. But whatever you do, don't watch it. It's so boring and bad. We're gonna talk about Run Rabbit Run, starring everyone's favorite Roy family member from Succession, Sarah Snook. You may also remember her from Predestination. If you're a fan of my other show, The New Flesh, I talk about that movie all the time. I love it. If you've never seen it, check it out. Indie sci-fi that's kind of mind-blowing. Check it out. Or check it out on markreviewsmovies.com on the archive.
Absolutely. Yep, I reviewed that one. Yeah, it's...
I'm assuming you liked it. It's good.
I did. Oh, yeah. It's...
Okay, great.
Yeah.
See,
maybe think about time travel in a completely different way. It's really
100%. And it's got, like, gender stuff going on that is, like, feels very modern, but it was like 10, 12 years ago or something.
Yeah, it's an older movie, and it was,
I think it's the Spierig brothers who have done other movies, like the Daywalkers, and I think they did a Saw, one of the Saws, like the late Saw sequels. Anyway, here is Run Rabbit Run, the trailer.
Can people come back?
Come back from where?
From where they go when they die.
I had a sister. Her name was Alice.
What was she like?
She liked animals. She'd find wild rabbits and bring them home.
You're so cute. I love you.
She went missing when she was only 7.
I'm 7.
I don't understand what's going on.
It's clear there's something troubling me.
I don't want to talk.
Stop the presses, Mark. We've got a disturbed child doing scary drawings. Sound the alarm. I had that alarm go off during Boogeyman too, actually. You guys just didn't hear it probably. All right. So Run Rabbit Run. Why are we... I'm assuming you did think it sucked too. Why does this movie suck so bad?
Because it is. Oh boy. Okay. It's creepy kid and confused mother, and mother doesn't know what's going on, and mother also has a lot of trauma in her past that is very vaguely alluded to and treated as a bunch of red herrings.
Don't get me started on that shit.
Oh my, I found it really disturbing that the movie is treating potential sexual or physical abuse as a red herring throughout the movie. You're like, oh, what's going on here?
Also, you're right, though. It's like withholding and extremely obvious in equal measure, right?
Yeah, well, because it's making a convincing argument that, like, oh, eventually we're going to learn it was something to do with the father. Oh, eventually it's going to be with the mother who's currently in a nursing home and is suffering from dementia. There's something going on there and there and there. And then, I mean, there's something else that the trailer unfortunately gives away that the movie doesn't tell you for a while.
Oh, shit.
No, don't worry about it. That's not on you. Okay. That's on them.
Well, I can cut it for the listeners, entirely. So that's good. No, I'll don't cut worry. It to them.
It's like right in the beginning of the trailer.
Oh, Jesus.
That's not your fault. That is entirely the marketing realizing, like, oh, we better give some people an idea of what's going on here. Because, yeah, that's the big problem with this movie, is that it is constantly trying to evade what's actually happening here, because it wants the big reveal to be a surprise. And it's really it's not much of one. It's not. Once everything kind of comes into place, it's like, oh yeah, okay, that's what happened. Okay.
A movie can't tease you constantly with information that's clear from moment one. It just doesn't work. It makes your movie not only boring, but like specifically a chore. It's like a chore to sit through. You're just like waiting for like the thing to happen. And then I found it so laborious and bad, and also derivative of a million other movies. It's like trying to be the, you know, every movie post Bob. I think we get elevated horror from the movie Babadook, which inspired every movie to be like a metaphor, which like, you know, horror in the past has always been about something, but that movie was very explicit. Like, here, people, here's what a metaphor looks like. It's one to one, very easy. And every movie since then has tried to do that with like, just, you know, just do it worse. It's just become worse and worse every time. And this one feels particularly late and uninteresting. It's like a particularly late and particularly uninteresting entry into like a post Babadook, what do you want to call it? Post Babadook metaphor horror, or not even metaphor horror, like trauma horror, I guess is what I would say it is.
Traumatic metaphorical horror.
Metaphorical, yes.
Traumatic horror. I don't, something along those lines. That's where this fits.
Trope,
it's not
city.
Scary. It's not scary for
not
for
remotely.
No, not at all. And I think that's because it's trying to take all this stuff way too seriously, and it doesn't work when you're just playing this big game with guess the trauma for an hour.
You're right. It's ridiculous. And it's also, again, just the degree to which it's derivative makes it so like you can predict every beat of it. You're like, okay, I bet we're going to have some, you know, violin swelling here. We're going to have the scary drawings here. You just start to be like, it starts to pile up tropes. I mean, we talked about this with Boogeyman, but Boogeyman is a much more effective scary movie than something like Run Rabbit Run, which is just like completely, there's nothing to this because other movies have done it better. And I had that same problem with Boogeyman, but I concede Boogeyman. I still gave it 2 stars, but like I concede it made me, it had effective scare sequences. This does not even have that. So for that, it gets a 1.5 from me.
Yeah, 1.5 for me too. I mean, Sarah Snook is good, obviously.
She's great.
She does what she can with this material, but it is just like, oh,
she has such an expressive face.
Yes.
She doesn't say anything. She's just like, her face acting is incredible. But the movie sucks. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. As I'm almost done with Succession. I waited until it was finished. And yes, nice. she does a lot of little tiny things with her face that just like, oh yeah, you express so much just with like a single move of an eyebrow or something.
I think I saw someone tweet about like, whoever's in relationships with her in life must have a hard time, because it seems like she must be very expressive when she is reacting to things. Or maybe not. Maybe it's just perfect acting. She knows what she's doing. Great actress. Love Sarah Snook. Hate this movie.
Not good. Speaking of
actors from Succession who are good, let's talk about Prisoner's Daughter, starring Logan Roy, not Shiv Roy, the patriarch. Brian Cox is in this. It's a Succession week at the movies. Here's the Prisoner's Daughter.
Hello?
It's Dad. I'm getting out soon.
All we know is what we've been.
Maxine, too late?
Mom, ask Dad for the money.
I'll handle it. I need money, Tyler.
Maybe if you let me see him, I might be a little more generous.
All we know is what we've been told.
In the time I have left, I would like to spend it with you.
I'll do it on one condition. You pay me rent.
Aw, what a heartwarming family tale. This father and daughter reconnecting. Gotta pay her rent. Anyway, that pretty much summed it up, but why don't you sum it up better? What is this movie, and why is it kind of bad enough that we both kind of hated it?
So Brian Cox plays a prisoner who is in jail for an unspecified but apparently really terrible crime, because he's going to be there, I guess until he dies.
It seems like vague hitman vibes. Like,
yeah, vague. Yeah. Definitely has beaten up people. It is suggested that he killed probably a couple people too. But they don't want to give you that because he's cleaned up. He's gone sober. He's helping other prisoners get sober. And that's what we want to focus on. And I'm cool with that. I'm cool if you want to just say, like, yeah, we are more than what we've done and people can move on and be reformed. I think that's a great message. Not for this movie, because this movie becomes all about all the terrible things that this character did that messed up his entire family life. So Kate Beckinsale plays his daughter, the prisoner's daughter, the titular eponymous prisoner's daughter, who brings him in because he's dying of cancer. He's going to die in a few months. And the warden lets him stay with a family member until he dies. And yeah, that's it. And then the rest of it is obvious. Like, they're going to reconnect and figure out all the stuff that went wrong in their past and have nice moments together. And there's a grandson too. And the grandson is going to be getting beat up by bullies. And so the grandfather is going to teach him how to fight, which is very confusing because the whole movie is very much anti-violence, except when violence is very convenient for the plot and for all of that to happen. It's such a confused movie. It's such a confused movie. And it's really too bad because Cox and Beckinsale are both good here. There's a lot of potential for, like, a movie about second chances and not being defined by your past and moving on from that. There's a potentially good story here, but instead it's all about the kid getting beat up by bullies and needing
violence. Oh my God.
There's a father. The father is either a loser drug addict who doesn't do anything or the most insane violent person imaginable, just depending on what the movie requires of him at the moment. I mean, that can happen in real life, obviously, but I'm just saying, like, it feels so contrived in this particular script because you're like, yeah, I know you need something to, you know, fight against in the last act. And it's annoying. It's so annoying.
It's very annoying. It wants to be a cancer movie. It wants to be a reconciliation movie. It wants to be a movie about an ex-con getting, you know, fixing himself or whatever. It's just a movie assembled entirely within the cliche factory. And every plot point, you're right, is so disingenuous, it's visible from a mile away. Just from the introduction, Mark, I wrote down, because the kid has a black eye when he meets the dad. And I'm like, the dad's going to teach him how to fight, isn't he? And that, I literally wrote down, teach him how to fight. And then it happened like 10 minutes later. Not to say I'm a fucking Nostradamus genius. I'm saying this movie is that bad. That it's just like, yeah, we'll do this over there, and then we'll solve it with this. It just... ugh, it just sucks. And she's like, everything, she's lying to his son about who he is, but the son obviously knows. Everyone's, I don't know, I would say Brian Cox and Kate Beckinsale are fine in this, but that kid is bad. I was annoyed. I hate to be mean to child actors, but sometimes they're bad and they're in bad movies. And
it's also not always their fault too. I mean,
no.
It's hard to write believable kids, and this kid is not written believably, and it's hard to direct kids too. And unfortunately, Catherine Hardwick didn't direct this kid,
you know,
well enough for it to work.
There's some like little details, like the mom putting water in the jelly to make more of it because they're poor. Like, there's little details that are lived in, and I was like, this is almost interesting. But
the,
like,
generic movie cereal that doesn't taste right. Like,
There are some details that it's like the world they're setting up is interesting, but the movie just falls flat. Do you think the prisoner's daughter knows the hitman's bodyguard, or maybe the hitman's bodyguard's wife?
Possibly.
Maybe they have a standing brunch with the Wolfman's brother.
That's a prequel crossover opportunity here, since we know nothing about this character and his past, except that he's a really bad man in the past.
Does this take place in the Mafia Mama cinematic universe? Is the Mafia Mama related to the prisoner's daughter? What if she is? Maybe she's a different... I don't know.
That's the big twist the whole time. It wasn't the father. It was the mother pulling the strings.
It was the Mafia Mama.
Before all of it happens.
That's if listeners are confused, Catherine Hardwick directed this film. She also directed another film this year, a film called Mafia Mama, starring Toni Collette. Check it out. It's on VOD now. It's not worth your time.
And we reviewed it when it came out, so, you know, do some searching
You watch it, internet. then you go watch, listen to us be befuddled by it because it was very confusing movie. All right, where are you at on this movie?
1.5 on this one.
I'll stick there with you. I'm 1.5 okay. as well. Let's jump to indie territory. A bunch of indies, mostly they're all foreign, I believe, different varieties, but I think this one's in English for sure. This is a New Zealand movie?
New Zealand, yeah.
Yeah, New Zealand. Millie Lies Low. I think I'm doing Aussie, and they hate that. I should stop. Millie Lies Low. This is the trailer. I'm sorry about all those impressions. I don't know what came over me. Millie Lies Low.
My name is Millie Davies. I'm going to be interning at one of New York's top architecture firms.
So you made it?
Yeah. This is an epic opportunity to step into the next chapter of my life.
What do you guys think of my exposed brick apartment? Anyway, I better go.
Wait,
I miss you guys.
Millie, what happened?
Hi, Millie. You hadn't turned up for your internship yet. Which is kind of strange, because from your Instagram post, it seems like you're having a great time in New York.
I see you, friend.
Oh, man. I thought this movie was really great, and if it stuck the landing, it could have had an extra half star for me. I think it kind of, it doesn't, like, lose itself or anything. I just think it gets a little silly, maybe, or a little too much, like, it has to wrap things up neatly, that I didn't appreciate, because I think the rest of it was so good. But this is a movie, Mark, that you could say is about Instagram versus reality. It's a movie about, you know, it's kind of like if you've ever wanted to attend your own funeral to see how people would react to you dying, this movie kind of has that quality to it. And I guess that's kind of like that movie, A Ghost Story, is kind of like that, right? Like a ghost lingering and like seeing what's going on after you're gone. This movie is about a woman who is about to move from New Zealand to New York. It's a big deal. She got a job. It's everyone threw her going away party. It's like set in stone. She's going. She has a panic attack on the flight and she has to throw herself off of the plane before they take off. Not in the air or anything. Crucial detail. But she's at the airport and she's trying to, you know, get her flight to New York because she is calmed down now and she can't afford it. It's like $2,000 or $3,000 or something. It is an absurd amount of money. And she just already wasted her other ticket. So instead of going to New York, she just starts lying to everybody in her life that she did and taking fake pictures and doing Photoshop and standing near exposed brick and pretending it's her apartment. It's so funny, but it's also so deeply sad and heartbreaking and so true about the way we use social media. There's one scene in particular where like she posts that she just got to New York or whatever it is and she's all excited. And she's watching the likes roll in and the camera lingers on her eyes and her face as she's so excited scrolling through the notifications. And like, as someone addicted to my phone, I will admit, like, I love these movies because it's like, damn, got my ass. I am addicted to my phone. I do feel that way when I get notifications. God damn it. So yeah, this movie is kind of about the feeling of being an outsider in your own life. And it gets at, like, you know, maybe the people you think have it together probably don't either. And like, it's just an interesting perspective because she's kind of haunting her own life because everyone thinks she left, but she's still there, literally going to the parties where they're at and hiding under a hoodie and like pretending to be in New York. And I just thought it was really fun. And maybe do you agree about the ending?
Oh, yeah, that's the ending. I had to think about the ending because, yeah, it does wrap up very simply. And that's too bad because, yeah, it is up until then. It's really funny. I found it kind of terrifying, too.
It is.
Just it's because.
Like Safdie Brothers intense.
Yeah, know? Because the whole thing is she does not want to be embarrassed. She would rather create this entire plan of faking being in an entirely different country than admit that she had a panic attack. Or admit that maybe she feels like she's an imposter in her own life. She would rather do all of that than just be embarrassed for a brief second. And yeah, the whole movie is setting up all of these situations where she could be discovered in an instant just from everything. And so watching her and sympathizing with her so quickly, and then watching her go through these experiences and just come right there so close to being found out and having that embarrassment is really scary. And then I also did appreciate the fact that the character isn't pure. I'm not going to explain exactly how, but there might be a reason she has imposter syndrome. It might not be a syndrome, basically. Yes. And I like that it juggles this level of sympathy and also just understanding, like, oh, there's something much deeper going on with this character that it kind of, I think maybe that's what the ending could be. They start to kind of touch upon, like, this is where all of this is stemming from. This is what she, her past is about. And maybe if it had confronted more of that instead of just trying to wrap everything up as cleanly as possible, maybe that would have been. Because there is a lot of thorny stuff with this character. There's a lot of stuff that...
Oh, you learn a lot about her mom and her dad.
Yeah. I really wish I had understood her a bit more, because the stuff that I did learn about her... I found fascinating and sympathetic and and frightening because all that. Anna Scottney plays Millie. She's great here.
Terrific.
Another actor, really great with just very subtly offering up facial expressions, and you can see everything. You're right. That scene of her looking at her Instagram feed and just the way her face lights up. There's another scene where she's just taking a bunch of photos and she's trying to get the look exactly right for both, like, the blue screen effect and also, like, laughing right before smiling as you know, they tell you you should do, but it's such a fake laugh. You're like, oh,
totally.
Like, it's
there's also that, like, working class nightmare aspect of it where, like, she's just this young woman who doesn't have a job and trying to get to New York without it's impossible. She can't get money. She tries to take out a loan. I love that scene because the guy's like, you know, like $10,000. What are you thinking? She's like, no, $2,000. Like, she just wants enough money for a plane ticket. She has nothing, no assets of value except her car that she gave to somebody else. So she goes and steals the car to get a loan so she could buy the plane ticket. It's just like, it's crazy. It's so fun to watch, but it's also like, you're right, it is kind of terrifying because you're just like, it's like, as I said, it's a Safdie brother mode of intensity where you're just like watching bad things happen to somebody. And you're like, ah, no. And they're clearly their own worst enemy in this situation. So, yeah, I think it's interesting. It's interesting. I love I really love the haunting your own life stuff where it's like, life goes on without you. And you don't realize that until you really see it before your eyes. And it's really good. I'm very close to 3.5, but I'm going to go with 3. It's a very good movie.
Yeah, I'm going with 3-2. Very, very strong 3. It's, you know, it's worth seeking out. It is, I think it's just in limited release right now, but I'm assuming it'll get some kind of digital release. It's Film Movement, so they have their own streaming service, I think. But
oh, wow.
Yeah, so definitely... Film Movement Plus, they call it. But
how hopefully original. It gets,
I know, hopefully, I mean, they do good stuff, so.
Yeah, no, I'm not, I'm just...
They give us movies like this.
Everybody in the industry decided to go with plus, which is kind of lame, but okay, better than minus, I suppose. All right.
Yeah.
Let's talk about a French movie called The Passengers of the Night. Here's the trailer.
Passagers de la nuit, mais tout cher. Nous sommes le 10 mai. C'est Vanda Dorval qui vous accompagne cette nuit encore jusqu'à 4 heures du matin.
Et donc, vous êtes une inconditionnelle de l'émission?
Oui.
Et pourquoi reprendre le travail maintenant, alors?
Je me suis séparée de mon mari. Enfin, il est parti.
Je comprends.
Comment tu vas faire? T'as jamais travaillé?
Merci.
Je suis désolée, c'est pas ce que je voulais dire.
L'appui sur le 3.
Ce soir, nous avons une nouvelle visiteuse. Quel est votre prénom?
Talula.
Vous avez quel âge?
18 ans.
Et vous vivez où depuis que vous êtes à Paris?
Des chambres d'hôtel ou des squats.
Tu peux pas rester là comme ça. Tu vas venir à la maison.
Oui, mais c'est qui cette fille?
Tu comptes adopter tous les chats errants du quartier?
Elle me touche, moi, cette gamine. Tu ressembles à un petit oiseau, tu l'as jamais dit.
This movie has all the hallmarks of something that could be such cliche garbage. It has, like, you know, the son falling in love with the girl who the mom takes in. It just has all these elements that you think could swirl up into something that's, like, cliche or bad or stupid. And this movie is so not interested in doing any of that. It is just like a look at the lives of ordinary people amid not political upheaval, but, like, I guess political change and how it, like, resonates with these characters. I don't know how to describe. It's like a certain type of filmmaking. I wish I were more well-versed in French cinema, because this movie seems to be like making very specific references to French movies that play in the movie and also are talked about. Maybe it's a movie about a lot of stuff. I'll let Mark take it in a second. But one thing I was blown away by to discover, it has nothing to do with anything, but there's a casual scene where somebody makes hot chocolate for somebody and they pour it in a bowl and eat it with a spoon. And I just, as an American, I don't know if you're listening overseas and that's how you eat it. Over here in America, we put it in a mug and we drink it while it's too hot and we burn the roof of our mouths.
With marshmallows.
With marshmallows.
To help cool it down.
Yeah, they don't have marshmallows in this.
Okay, also. Good. I'm glad you reminded me of that, because I was like, what are you doing? I'm going to have hot chocolate. She takes a bowl out. I'm like, what?
It was so one of those
oatmeal?
Moments.
Is it like chocolate oatmeal or something? No, it's just, it's milk with
they,
chocolate.
They said hot chocolate, but it might
they
be
did,
something
and it
different.
Is.
Yeah.
No, okay. It's they drink it out of the bowl with a spoon. It's like soup. I don't, okay. We're going to spend way too much time on this. I don't, okay. So yeah.
It's a very low-key hangout movie is like what I was trying to get at. There's not a lot of plot to it at all.
There's very, very little plot.
And I'm assuming a lot of people won't like it. But like, why did we like it?
Because it feels like you're living with these characters over the course of what? It's about, it starts in 81 with the election. I think it jumps ahead to 84. And by the end, so like maybe 4 or 5 years with these characters. And I mean, this is going to sound terrible for people who don't like movies without a plot, but you feel that passage of time, and you need to feel that passage of time, because you get to see how these characters grow and don't grow, how their circumstances change and how they adjust to it, and how quickly things that seem so monumental become so ordinary. That's what I really appreciate about this film, is that it opens up with the 81 election, which was like this big momentous occasion. There are people celebrating in the streets. There's archival footage of people celebrating in the streets. And then the next time you see it, like, oh, that's it. Life's just back to normal. We've had that experience in this country when we had, you know, all the promise of change and hope with an election, and everything just, you know, it went back to normal. It's fine. You know,
yeah.
That's just how things go in life.
And like amid that huge political change that's like meaningful and positive, you know, Charlotte Gainsbourg's character is like going through a tough experience, like recently divorced.
Yeah.
Like, it's just like interesting to like have all those characters set against this backdrop and let it not be like completely where like every character is, you know, perfectly metaphor related to the up the change. It's like, no, she's actually opposed, you know, in the other direction. Like, she's going the other, she's not happy at the moment. And I think that's all very interesting.
She's not happy, but she has adjusted. She's, you know, separated from her husband, but, you know, life just goes on because that's what it has to do.
Exactly.
The character Tallulah that she comes into the radio station where she starts working at, and just, she's lived her entire life on the streets, just going from place to place and trying to find places to sleep and eat and just sit for a bit. You know, you think like, oh, we had this big, massive political movement, and that's her life still, even after all that. So it's sort of this whole, it's a critique of this optimism that, you know, politics and everything is going to save us and fix everything. It's like, yeah, it's not always going to do that. There's still going to be people on the fringes who aren't helped because nobody thinks to care about them. There's just a lot of really nice details and going on here in terms of the political stuff. It's not overtly political, but it's there. A lot of great character work that you come to understand these characters. The son is very aimless until he realizes, oh, I could be a poet, and he finds this whole structure to his life, and you see that. The daughter is just kind of joking and everything, and suddenly she becomes very politically active. You're like, oh, this is nice to see. And that scene with Gainsbourg going to her daughter's apartment for the first time is great. Because again, it's just like, this is such a monumental change, and she just has to adjust to it because that's just the way life is now.
Yeah, people, I feel like in this movie, people speak their feelings in a way that people in American movies wouldn't. Like, Gainsbourg is in her daughter's apartment like, wow, I can't believe I'm here in your apartment. It's so fucked up and weird that like, you were once my child and now you're here. Like, yeah, it's just a very thoughtful, I mean, it's definitely a disjointed movie, but because of what it's doing, but like, I think it all works to tell this story about we're all just passengers in the night, right? Like, what does that expression mean to you? Like, I like the way it comes to play in the movie as like the
radio
voice.
I also, It's not really a spoiler, but I really like the way that that archival footage is interspersed through the narrative. And by the end, the way that the characters kind of become part of that archival footage.
Yeah.
Just the way that formal trick of just it just says so much. Like this is history. What we're watching this entire movie, that's history. It's just ordinary people living ordinary lives through a whole bunch of stuff going on in the world.
You're right. Like that, it's such a quiet thing, but the implication of it is so staggering that I was like kind of blown away by the movie too. It's very low key. It's not going to be for everybody, but if you're into like low key art films, I think you'll find a lot in this. It's very good. Three stars for me.
Three stars too. Sorry, I jumped over you. Three stars too. Yeah,
that's okay. Let's move right on to the movie that you saw last week. I caught up with this week. I still don't think it's playing, or it's actually on VOD now. You can rent this on VOD as of today. Rodrigo Cortez made it's a Spanish production about the Holocaust. And is it in English? It is in English.
Yep.
Yeah, that's right. Love Gets a Room. Here's a trailer.
Ladies, 2 minutes to curtain today. They will take their hands out of their coats and clap. We have to go on stage.
They make a good couple, don't they?
We have to talk. We're leaving the ghetto.
What?
We're leaving the ghetto, you and me, tonight.
All I ever reach is fruitless when I'm not.
Patrick wants to escape tonight after the show.
But do you want to go with him?
No.
Do you want to stay here?
No, I want to be with you.
Beside you.
I've loved a lot of men. Believe me, it's always another. Go with Patrick.
I don't love him.
If he won't let you go, then maybe...
Maybe what?
Maybe he doesn't really love you.
Write your next song for someone who cares about you.
What matters here is being loved, child. Not loving.
What happened here?
What have we done?
I think I just realized my YouTube's been playing at like 1.5 speed this entire time. So the trailers were a little sped up, I think, this time. But maybe that's why we're getting 8 movies in like 80 minutes. So maybe it's a good thing. All right. Let's talk about Love Gets a Room. Mark, what is this very nice movie? Very sweet.
Very sweet, but also, you know.
Terribly sad. Yes.
Exactly.
It's like
it's
Life is Beautiful mode.
Kind of. So it's set in the Warsaw Ghetto in 1942. It is done in real time, and it is takes place over the course of like this performance of a musical comedy in the Warsaw Ghetto, as people are dying in the streets and hungry and starving, and there are gunshots ringing out. There's people going to a theater to try to escape reality, watching a musical comedy that is about the Warsaw Ghetto. This is an actual play. I was shocked to learn this. And it is so revealing about just the power of art to just be like, this is the power of art is to help us to escape. Yes. But also to give us enough of reality that there is a reason to escape. I really love that they take excerpts from this real play, from a real playwright that I had never heard of, who was writing and producing plays in the Warsaw Ghetto in the same theater where this takes place in. Just this fascinating little piece of history that I had never considered before, but obviously it happened. Obviously it had to happen. People needed to have some escape. So you get this play, and then you also get the backstage drama happening where this young woman is torn between two men that she loves or loved at one point, who both want her to get out of the ghetto. That's basically it. And she has to decide, is she going to leave? And if she's going to leave, who is she going to leave with? And how is that going to work? It's really, really fascinating to watch it. And, it's directed by Rodrigo Cortez, who, if you saw Buried, that's what it's called, right? Buried with Ryan Reynolds, he can do a lot with the camera in very
Roaming camera is awesome.
Yeah, can find places and spaces and all that. And there is that sense of this as the camera is just moving around. There's this great one take at the beginning where you go through the streets of Warsaw in the ghetto, and you see all this misery, and then as soon as you go into the theater, everything is bright, the stage lights are all up, and you're like, okay, yep, this is where we are. This is some relative safety from all of this. And then you just get to watch all this unfold. It's not all one take, but the camera work is fantastic. It gives you that sense of claustrophobia and also of just moving around with these characters that their lives are up in upheaval while this play is going on.
It's
really good stuff.
The roaming camera I wrote down also, very impressive. But like the specificity of opening it with like her just getting to the theater to do the rehearsal, or no, not the rehearsal, to do the play. And it's like the shit these people had to endure to even get to entertain, like enduring the checkpoints and the hunts just to like get there. And, you know, the ghetto is no place for love stories, I think someone says, but like, you know, telling the story, you know, you find out that it is. And like, I just found it. Yeah, I also found it quite beautiful and very immersive in both the camera work and the score. The score was really good. The score was very expressionistic, I would say, like very like loud when it needs to be, etc. It's a great, you know, you could say it. The Show Must Go On would be a great title for this movie. Art imitating life, imitating art. The power of, I love the scene where they like change the context of the scene. They're worried about it because there's like a Nazis in the audience, and oh man, how tense it gets when the Nazi guards enter the room.
Yeah, he walks in and it's just everything goes silent.
They have to keep, the show must go on. They have to keep doing it. And he's there to intimidate them. And we know from earlier, like, oh my God, like he's making everyone smile and laugh, even though they're all sitting there getting killed. It is dark and terrifying in ways that all the Holocaust movies should be. But it's very, I don't know, life-affirming? Is that the word I want to use? Like, it's very, if you're a person who loves movies and theater and art or anything and appreciate the value of it, it really will speak to you. Because you're right, it is impressive that, like, you know, even in the worst possible of times, art is there and it's a solve for people. Great. It's a good movie. 3 stars for me if you can. Oh, yeah, I would say if you could find it, but it's on VOD. You can rent this.
Yeah, I'm glad you caught up with it. Yay. It's 3 stars for me, too. It's definitely worth checking out.
Awesome. And that was 8 movies out the weekend of Friday, June 30th. Do I have any notes? All I wanted to say is, you know, the maxim on the internet is never read the comments, but it's all I do is read the comments. I haven't finished a book in years. I no longer subscribe to magazines. So if you're on YouTube and you write a comment, I will read it, including the ones that say I interrupt Mark too much. And I hope you'll notice that it was much better this week. I didn't interrupt so much. I'm learning. I bet Mark feels the same way, by the way, as the person getting interrupted all the time.
I'm good. I'm good.
I just had to say it. I'm aware, everyone. We're always getting better all the time at this show. I like to think, what a fun journey you can watch me improve. It's a podcast with character arcs. How exciting. And our boy James is still out there getting really angry about the Alien Ant Farm song. Actually, last week was the best one because it was the shortest episode yet, right? So the episode was only 47 minutes long. And I believe James said, and I quote, "The worst thing about there only being 3 films this week is that it makes the show a lot shorter, and therefore Alien Ant Farm takes up a higher percentage of time. I've done some maths. Last episode, Alien Ant Farm took up 5.84% of the show. The episode before that, 4.74. This week, it took up a whopping 9.47% of the show. Utterly disgusting. And with that, Alien Ant Farm.
The show starts in one.
Emotion, we seem Tell yourself. Shut up. Oosh.